All right, everyone, welcome back. In the previous video, we finished off our cinematic. We finished shot 7 and 8. So we have this shot here, where our bear gets shot down, and then our final shot, where the camera kind of pulls out, passes through this little gate, and then what we'll do is just fade out the scene at this point, closing out our cinematic. So our sequence is complete. We're gonna do some final finishing touches here in this video. In the next video, we'll do sort of a bonus video where we talk about alternate takes. We'll do an alternate take of some of these shots. And then we'll talk about the master sequence that I mentioned earlier on in the series and how you can use it, as well as maybe use this rig crane and rig rail. Maybe we'll try to use those. If nothing else, we'll just show you how you can use them. So let's continue and finish off our cinematic here. Let's see, the first thing that we're gonna wanna do is, we mentioned for this particular shot here, we wanna slow down time and make them kind of rise in slow motion, because that will look pretty cool. So we're gonna go ahead and do that. We're gonna do that with a play rate track. Now usually what I would do is add the play rate track from the master level here, so you can see where in each shot slowdown occurs, or if you want to increase speed, you can do that as well. But I know the sequencer team is working on this particular track, as well as functionality associated with it. So as a workaround for now, what we're gonna do is hop into shot 6. Actually, let's start at the beginning of shot 6 here. So at about frame 660, jump into shot 6, jump into our sub scene, which has all of our animation in it. And this is where we're going to add our play rate. So I'm gonna hold control and mouse wheel down to zoom out. Make sure I get, there we go. So about here is where we're gonna do our slowdown. So I'm gonna actually hop back one frame just by hitting the left arrow. So we're at frame 659. And let's add our play rate track. So I'm gonna click add play rate track. And 1.0 is normal speed. So I'm gonna add a keyframe for that. And let's move the marker ahead one frame to the start of this shot where we want our slowdown to occur. And you can use whatever play rate you want. I'm gonna actually slow this down to 10%. So I'm gonna say 0.1, like so. And a quick shortcut time, I'm gonna click this keyframe here, and if I hit 5 on my keyboard, that will change the interpolation type. We're gonna have this be a constant. You can also right click and go here as well and select, but you can use the number keys 1 through 5 to select these as well. So we're gonna change this to a constant, and let's hop back up to the master real quick and get to the end of this shot. So about there, hop back into shot 6, hop back into our sub scene, should be at the end of the shot now. We're gonna add a keyframe for 1.0 again. So you should have 3 keyframes there, and our scene will play in slow motion from here. So that looks pretty cool. Looks good. There is a couple other things that we'll need to do. If we hop back up to the shot 06 level, and we play that same sequence. In fact, let's go to the master level and take a look at this and go back to shot 06. You're gonna notice some choppiness, and we need to fix that. So we can hop back into shot 06. Wait, let's start from the beginning. Shot 660, or frame 660, shot 06. So this is where it starts, frame 192 inside shot 06. So if we play from here, you're also gonna see that choppiness. But you'll notice our camera moves kind of smooth. The animation is a little bit choppy. So there's a couple things we need to do to fix this. So let's go in to our sub scene. First thing we're gonna do is we're gonna go to the general options here, click this option. Under playback, this sequence, there's an option called force fixed frame interval playback. What this does is, the tooltip says, forces scene evaluation to a fixed frame interval in the editor, even if this would result in duplicated or dropped frames. We're not going to want to use this since we're slowing down time. We don't want to force it to a fixed frame interval. So we're going to uncheck this, and we're going to hop up to the shot 06 level and do the same thing here. And then we'll hop up to the master and do it there as well. So now what we should see is what we'd expect if we play. Nice, smooth animation. Now there's one thing I noticed about shot 06, it's still bugging me. There's a little bit of a hitch there on our bear. I could go in and mess with the keyframes and get it just right, but instead what I'm going to do is chop that frame out. So we have the frame. If we play, it's like right there. So I'm going to go in a couple frames, start right here. 663, going to hit Control and hit comma. Just cut that out. Going to select all of my remaining shots here and just slide them over. So now that should be gone. Don't see that pop anymore. So that looks good. Put it all on the same track, which I don't want to do. So let me just pop that up. All right, so we have the slowdown there. Let's see, let's go ahead. The next thing that we're going to want to do is let's add a particle effect for this shot here. So when the character shoots, we have some kind of a particle effect. So we're going to want to do that probably at frame 723, it looks like, somewhere around in there. We're going to do this inside, if we go inside of our Shadow 7, we'll do it inside of the subscenes, the animation subscene track here. Could have a separate track for effects, but since we're only using one effect really for this, I'm just going to do it inside the subscenes track for animation. But let's go ahead and do that. So I'm going to jump into the subscenes track. And if I press home, we'll zoom out. So right here at frame 727 is when we want to activate our particle effect. We need to add it first. So I'm going to go to the content browser and the Infinity Blade effects. There's tons of effects in here. The one that we're going to be using, though, is called Player Fire Strong. There it is. P-Impact Player Fire Strong. So we're going to drag this into the level now. Just left click, drag it in. That green arrow that you see there is the direction in which the particle will launch, which is not that way, so we don't want that. So I'm going to hit E, just rotate it around so it's facing our bear. Like that. And then I'm going to line it up with this cannon here. I could go into pilot mode and pilot it directly in there, but I'm going to try and eyeball it here. Just W to kind of move that up. And just move it over, up. Just kind of push it back. Something like that. If you need to, turn off grid snapping. I don't know if I did that in between videos or not, but you can turn off grid snapping to get a smooth smooth placement. Now, over in the details panel, we're going to uncheck one option for this real quick, for this particle. Auto activate. We don't want it to auto activate. We're going to tell it through sequencer to activate. So I'm going to uncheck this. And you can recheck it real quick just to test to see what it will look like. It should fire it again, which that looks pretty good. Looks good to me. So I'm going to leave it unchecked. With it still selected, we're going to go to sequencer. We're then at frame 727 here. We're going to click add actor 2 sequencer. And we've added it. Now we need to add a track for it. And that track is the particle toggle track. So go ahead and select that. And then finally, there's a particle system component here. There's a dropdown. We want to activate it. And then we want to add a keyframe at frame 27 or 727 to activate it. So at frame 727, it will activate it and we'll see it. Now we won't see it inside the editor here, but when we play here in a second to test everything out, you'll see it play when we play our game here. So we've added a cinematic. Let's see, the last thing that we'll do is, let's go ahead and add our audio to kind of tie everything together here. Well, there's two more things actually. Let's add our fade in and fade out. Let's do that before we do our audio. So we're gonna hop back up to the master level here. We'll do the fade in and fade out on the master level. It's pretty easy. I'm gonna go back to the beginning of the shot here and let's add what's called the fade track, which does exactly what we want it to do, fade in and fade out. So let's select that. That'll add the fade track. Now, 0 represents no fade. 1.0 represents a full fade or black. So to start, we want to start out on black. So I'm going to set this to 1.0, and then press Enter. And we need to keyframe that, so I'm going to add a keyframe for that. And let's see. Right now, we're at still using frames, so I don't know how long this is actually going to fade in. What we could do is we can go to this dropdown here and uncheck Show Frame Numbers. It will now show time to show us how much time has surpassed. So we'll say something like, we'll keep it short, something like 2 seconds, I guess. And then we'll change this back to 0. Press Enter to add a keyframe. So we should have a fade in after 2 seconds, which looks pretty good. I think that's good enough. So we're going to do the same thing towards the end here. Before we do that, let's see, where's our time at? We're ending our sequence at about 31 seconds. I'm going to bump this up by another second or so. So it's going to actually end at about 32. Let's say 32.50. Let's see what that will do. So we're going to go to 32.50, and we're going to hit the right closed bracket. That's where our marker is going to be. Reason we're doing this is we're going to leave some dead space here so that when it fades to black at this point, we can fade out our music as well, which we'll do here in a second. So it'll be on a black screen and our music will still be fading out. You'll see how this will work here in a second. Okay, let's fade it out. So we'll go, let's go to, say, 28, I guess. I guess we could do Control G and just say 28 as well. And we could say at this point we're 0, so we're not faded out. And we'll go to the end of our sequence here, which is about 31, and we'll say 1.0. So at this point, it's faded all the way out, and our music will still sort of be fading out here at the end, which would be perfect. So speaking of music, let's add our music. And then we could test the whole thing out and see what it looks like. So we'll jump back to the beginning here. Just about done. Let's add an audio track. Now, the audio track in Sequencer and its current functionality is still lacking some of the features that we want to get in there. We're still working on this. So right now, all you can do is add audio. So you can add a sound wave or a sound cue. Go ahead and select the sound cue for the Battle Lines sound cue. So that'll add it. We don't have the ability to add additional tracks to this, such as the ability to handle fading directly inside of Sequencer of our audio track. We can't add an audio component or anything, really. All we can do is add audio. But we have a workaround for this for now. What we could do is just edit our cue to fade in and out for us. So let's go ahead and do that. Because what's currently going to happen is when we get to the end, it's just going to stop. And we don't want that. So let's go ahead and fix that. We can right-click on this. Go to the properties, hit this magnifying glass to browse to it in the content browser, open up the sound cue, and this is going to be the sound cue editor. Is a little bit outside the scope of what we want to tackle. We're not going to completely go into detail in this, but we're going to do what we need to do to make our audio the way that we want. And what we'll need is what's called an enveloper here. If you left click, drag and drop that into the graph here, what we have is our sound wave. We have the final output. It's going to get passed through this enveloper with the parameters that we want and then spit out as the final output. So let's take this pin here, just left click on it, drag it, plug it in there. Take the output, left click, drag it, and plug it in there. Then select the enveloper. And over in the details panel, we have this volume curve, which is currently has one key, which says at time 0, play the value being 1.0 or full volume. So what we can do is if we right click in here and then we hold shift and left click, we can add another key and we could say roughly about, let's see, we'll say 33 seconds. About 33 seconds, we want a value of 1.0. We can click these two icons here to get a full representation of our graph there. I'm gonna hold shift and left click one more time and add another key. And for this key, we'll say at about 38 seconds, we want our value to be 0 so that it effectively fades out the audio. And you can mouse wheel in and out to kind of see that as well. Full volume gets to 33 seconds, starts to fade out, and is completely out at 38 seconds. So that's our fade in and fade out, really. So we can close this out. That's all we need to do. Go to Sequencer. We should be done at this point. Let's test this out. Inside the level here, I'm right clicking, gonna find our level sequence, our master. You can also get to it to the world outliner here. Just search for level sequence or level and it should come up. Select it, and then in the details panel we want to check autoplay. Now there's other ways that you can trigger sequences through blueprint script, and there's some documentation on this as well. But for us, we want this sequence to play whenever we start our level. So with that, we should be good to test. Let's check it out. I'm going to hit this drop down here and say play in a new editor window. And let's see what it looks like. Pretty good, not too bad. It says lighting needs to be rebuilt in the upper left up there, which we could just go to this option and say build lighting only, which you can do here in between videos if you'd like. There was a little bit of jitteriness there. Don't worry about that too much when you render out your movie, which we'll do in the next video as well. It should clean most of that up, as well as some of the things that we're doing on our end with our sequencer team to fix some of the playback issues as well. So that's actually going to do it for this video. If you'd like, go ahead and build lighting. It'll take a little bit to do it. You may get some overlapping UV error messages, warning messages. Don't worry about those. It's fine for the purposes of what we're doing. So I'm going to build lighting in between videos here as well. And in the next video, our bonus video, we're going to learn about alternate takes, the master sequence, and some of the other cinematic tools available in Sequencer. So that's going to do it for this video. Thank you so much, and we'll see you in the next video.